Puppies. It's What's for Breakfast.
We're all set to begin, so let's dive right in to Bikers, Dice, and Bars. Talking bicycles and motorbikes, gamer things and all the like. You can listen to it in your cars, but mostly it's about dive bars. Bikers, Dice, and Bars.
Hey, Linsel. What are we drinking tonight?
Tonight, we are experimenting with Haymaker's Punch, otherwise known as Switchel, a 17th century Caribbean beverage made from a combination of ginger, molasses, apple cider vinegar, and in this case, a little hit of cinnamon. I drink it as a non-alcoholic alternative when I'm struggling with gout. But as others here at the table can attest to, it may mix with other beverages as well. Xander, what have you got in front of you?
So adding to the Switchel that Linsel has brought, we have Bayou Rum from Louisiana.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Silver. Silver Bayou Rum is handcrafted in traditional copper pot still, using 100% natural Louisiana cane sugar and molasses by folks that know fine rum. Taste the smooth and subtle character of Silver Bayou Rum over ice, or in your favorite cocktail for premium drinkability. Taste the spirit of Louisiana.
I've never had it before, and being a Southerner, I figured I kind of would have, but that's really delicious.
Delicious and, with gator bites.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and an absolutely gorgeous bottle with a pretty sexy looking alligator on it.
Mm. Now, this Switchel, what's the story behind it? You make this yourself?
I do. I've been brewing it myself for some time. It's not a very difficult process. Essentially, you've got to grind up ginger root, steep it in hot water, mix equal parts molasses and apple cider vinegar, and then you can add additional sweeteners if you like. Sometimes I put a little bit of Lyle's golden syrup or honey in it. That's pretty common. And obviously you can make it as sweet or as tart as you like. And the idea is that it's a thirst quenching punch that is was common, especially during Depression era, as a beverage for people who are working in the fields. Because of the ginger content, you don't drink it as fast as you would if you were just drinking cold water. And so it allows your body to absorb it a little faster or a little bit more healthfully. One of my jars is full of a Switchel mix that I've made that's ginger and molasses. The other is actually without the molasses, so it doesn't have any sweetener. It's just really concentrated ginger with just a touch of vinegar.
It's quite nice.
It is. It definitely has a burny quality to it if you drink it straight, but I thought it might be worth mixing.
And it does mix very well with the rum. Now, I've only started with the original mixture here, not the stripped down one. So I'll probably switch to that in a bit. But so far, I'm really digging this. I could just drink this casually.
Yeah, this is actually a beverage that I used to make and bring into the tugboat all the time when I was bartending, in part because as a bartender, you can't really drink while you're working. I mean, some bartenders can, but I couldn't. So I was nice having a beverage that I could pull out and drink across the counter from somebody that I wouldn't drink so fast, because I'm the kind of guy who can knock down a liter of water without really thinking about it.
Yep.
I'm the same way. I drink so fast. Yeah. And I just enjoy imbibing liquid, so...
Something about that. I know it totally makes sense, because I enjoy imbibing liquids too, but saying it is very strange.
I know, it does sound strange, but I came to grips with this some time ago when I realized I was getting way too drunk, way too fast, and it's simply because if there was something in my hand, I was going to drink it.
Yep.
So having something like this, I did notice that I would be more reserved with something with a high ginger content. Mm-hmm. So I started switching to vodka gingers, or what do you call it? Dark and stormies, or things.
Mules.
Yeah.
Kentucky mules.
The various and many mules.
That's the same reason why when I'm at home, I drink out of a tankard.
It's with the tequila.
Sure. A larger vessel always slows you down.
It's heavier, and so I'm more... The fact that I have a beverage in my hand is more present in my awareness, so I'm not just hammering it back.
Sure. Also, a little bit of an arm workout, too,
if you have the right one.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, there is one other drink on this table.
Oh, there is.
Jacob?
Yep. Just Jacob here with the original Olympia beer. It's the water since 1896.
It's not the same water that it was in 1896, though, right?
Shut your mouth. Don't remember asking you a goddamn thing.
For a change of pace, this time I'm bringing the bike topic for our show, and it's something that we've kind of touched on a few episodes already.
Can't help ourselves.
We've skirted around this issue, and we're going to get to it in a second, but I'm going to introduce it with discussion about the concept of the last mile. The last mile being a term in travel of having to figure out that last bit of transportation after you've gotten to your location for a long distance travel, you've flown somewhere, and now you got to figure out how to get around, depending upon how much distance you have to travel while you are at your location. Some people just rent a car. Some people use cabs. Some people...
public transit.
They get a bus pass or do something like Lyft or Uber.
Hmm.
And it's a very interesting topic of something that I didn't actually know all that much about until the last couple of years when we started seeing other alternative modes of transportation come up. I first started hearing discussion about the last mile, and it first became something that I was conscious of when bike town stands started appearing around Portland.
The yellow or the orange ones.
The orange Nike bike town.
Sure.
Rent-a-bikes.
And yes. One of the things that people talked about is that they were starting to offer these alternative modes of transportation, these as solutions to something like this. One might say the manually powered version of Cardigo or Zipcar.
Sure.
Yeah, yeah.
Have any of you experienced these?
Yes.
As in, have we used them? Is that the question?
Have you used them?
Yeah. Yes.
No. Usually when I travel, I bring my own bicycle if I'm traveling on train on the West Coast. So.
But what about when you fly?
When I fly, I've never used the bikes. I usually go for public transit in that case. Or if an emergency happens, I'll use Uber or Lyft.
Interesting. Yeah. I'll rent a car or sure. I'll just take cabs. And things like Uber and Lyft have brought new horizons.
Sure.
Made new possibilities of instantaneous access to travel as opposed to waiting for public transportation, having to figure out this town's arcane wherever you are, trying to figure out their arcane system of buses and trams to get where you want to go. When I first moved to Portland, I found the tramette system to be much better than it was in Atlanta, and yet still confusing as hell.
Yeah, daunting.
I like using local public transit when I go to new places because I feel like that's how I get to meet interesting people and kind of see how everybody...
Sometimes too interesting, though.
No, absolutely. That's not incorrect.
Yeah.
But it gives me a feel for the city that you don't really get if you're just kind of in a car, whether it's your own or a rented car or a Lyft or something like that. Because it kind of puts you in the heart of it and you really kind of see how the city beats. And I like that.
I'm with you in towns where people actually talk to each other.
Well, I don't need to talk to them. Yeah. And if I do,
you just want to look at them.
Yeah,
it's best for people watching, is what you're saying.
It's great people watching, but also, you know, you get to see, you know, the things that are on the subway. You get to see the things that are on the buses. You get to see, and it gives you kind of a much slower pass in the world if you're taking a bus, for instance. And I enjoy that. And even just waiting in line with people. I found in most cities, people are very helpful. If you're like, I don't know where the fuck I'm going. Can you help me, please?
Yeah, certainly.
Because usually the employees don't care and they're usually kind of disgruntled, but the people who actually have to rely on it are usually very nice and very helpful.
The last few times I've had to travel, actually, I went to Iceland and Ireland for my honeymoon, and we certainly made good use of Lyft and Uber or one of those car share programs while we were over there. And I was surprised at how wonderful it was to have somebody, especially because a lot of English speakers in both Iceland and Ireland.
There are problems.
More in Iceland, actually.
Yes.
in a sense, we almost had like a little tour guide, somebody to talk to us a little bit about the city for those drives that we took. And that I felt like it gave me more of a flavor for those places that we'd visited than a lot of the time that we had on the streets.
I wonder if that's a foreign country thing. Because here in America, here in Portland, I haven't experienced Uber or Lyft anywhere else. But at least here in Portland, I have yet to meet a native driver.
Yeah.
Everyone is from out of town, and they don't know enough to give you that experience.
Well, that's because we're in Portland. Everybody's from somewhere else.
I can say that from my experiences taking Uber and Lyft in different cities in this country, that I've gotten a lot of really helpful and good information from the people who are driving, because they might not be from, say, New York City or Charleston or wherever, but they've been there for long enough to know kind of the ins and outs. And if you say, man, where do I get the best barbecue? They will tell you.
Sure.
if you want to know where to get, you know, the like where's the cheap watering hole? They will tell you. And it's been a really good experience. And I agree with you, in Portland, it's been different, but in other places that I've gone to, especially on this latest trip that I took, it was nice. People are very open.
When I go places outside of wherever I'm living, I tend to be there on business. So the rent-a-car or the cab system has been the way I travel. I either had a company vehicle because I was driving there, or they paid me to rent a vehicle when I got there because I was usually on a very tight timeline, or I was using cabs. That said, I would use cab drivers for the exactly what you're talking about.
Yeah, I was going to say, cabs have forever been that resource.
If I was flying someplace, I would routinely take a cab from the airport to wherever I was going, even though I could take one of the shuttle buses, because I could engage with the cab driver and plot out my evening of, I'm done flying and now I need to get drunk. Where's the bar that I can feel real with? I tend to avoid public transit because I'm a weirdo magnet. That's how I ended up on the podcast. If there's a schizophrenic meth addict on the bus, they will find me.
They will be your new best friend.
So I tend to be a little leery of that, but I try to do it. I'm also a really big walker. What I consider a short walk, other people are like, you did 32 blocks to get groceries? Yeah, no problem.
Talking about walking for the last mile too, I recently got an iPhone, and now it has a little step tracker on it, which I never really paid attention to before. And on my vacation, with the missus, we have this whole thing where we just walk everywhere for the most part. And our light days of walking are like 7 to 8 miles a day.
Yep.
Wow.
That's a light day for us. And
that's a joke.
I think the heaviest day of walking we both did was 11 or 12 miles
on vacation. As somebody with a Fitbit, I've had one for quite a while. I have noticed routinely that my vacations give me more steps and more distance than my regular life. That's actually not uncommon. And it's things like conventions, especially conventions.
Oh, yeah.
I'll get 25,000 steps in a day on average if I go out to GameStorm or to Wagon Con.
Well, and I really do feel that walking gives you the best feel of a town that you have not been in. There's no better way to experience it.
Yeah.
Because even if you're driving and you see something cool, or even if you're biking and you see something cool, you can't always just stop immediately and go see whatever that thing is you're interested in. You might have to circle the block. You might have to go, the ebb and flow of traffic does not allow this right now. Or if you're on the sidewalk, yes, I am going to check out this KGB theme bar in New York City right now. Yes, I am.
Going back to where you started with the Nike Bike Town. God, I hate those things. There's one corral 2 blocks from where I live. There is another corral outside the front door of the building I work in. I should be their target demographic. I hate the things with a passion.
Why?
Because
you don't like the bikes.
First of all, the way they deployed them and set them up took out some very valuable parking in a lot of areas, and the exchange for the number of bikes that are placed for the number of parking slots we lost is not a practical trade-off. Second of all, the bikes are heavy, clunky, very poor maneuverability, and the built-in lights suck.
Really?
So we're talking technical difficulties with the bikes that are provided. Now, what about the concept of the bikes? The concept of bike sharing.
Has anybody here been in Portland long enough to remember the yellow bikes?
No, I don't remember you.
I do not remember.
We'll pick up some old history.
That's exactly correct. Actually, I'm sure that's where most of them are. Or they're somewhere in the Midwest, painted black. But there was an old program here in Portland back, I think it was late 80s, early 90s, where they had these really ugly yellow bikes that they put all over the city. And the idea was that you could just hop on one and ride one. There was no membership. There was no pay fee or anything like that. It was all very forward thinking. And of course, all those bikes were stolen and painted.
So I'm going to say that I like the concept of a cheap, easy rent-a-bike thing where I just need to go from point A to point B. I don't want to take the bus. I don't want to walk. I don't want to drive. It's a great concept that I very much appreciate in theory. I don't think most cities have done them well. When I was in Seattle not too long ago, it was different than the Nike bike shares, because in Nike ones, you have to lock it up to a very specific spot or else they penalize you. Whereas in Seattle, you can just kind of leave them anywhere, which has, again, its ups and downs as far as just fucking bikes everywhere strewn across the streets that you have to kind of maneuver over. But and I don't know what the solution is to make it a better system, but I like the concept.
At the 30,000 foot level in a metropolitan area, in an abstract sense, I like the idea of the bike share. In Portland, I dislike the implementation of it. And in our local political culture, it is used as a further way for developers to create non-sustainable housing.
So at a 30,000 foot level, I like the idea of cars. However, here in Portland, they're implemented poorly. Our infrastructure doesn't really support them anymore. And our city planners use them as an excuse to not have any progress whatsoever.
Yep.
Concur.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, and I'm in that weird situation too, where I know a lot of hardcore bike people just want cars to go and die. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of hardcore car people want bikes to go and die.
I'm a biker, and I wouldn't mind cars mostly not dying, but thinning out a bit.
Yeah, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that either. However, I'm also that person, too, that believes in the freedom of movement, and I want to be able to go and get into a car and just drive wherever the fuck I want to go. And I want to, like, if I want to take a road trip tomorrow, I like the fact that we own a car and I can just go.
Yeah. One of the benefits of things like bike sharing and Car2Go, Uber, Lyft, and so on is that you don't have to worry so much about the destination. You don't have to worry about where did I lock my bike up. You don't have to worry about having all the extra stuff. You can go there. You can take a Car2Go to your destination. And in Portland, Car2Go's, because of the company, they're licensed to park in any public parking spaces. You can just leave the car there. Mm-hmm. And you're at your destination. You don't have to worry about it anymore.
I think those things work for a lot of people. And I think that more than, say, Uber or Lyft, I think are good things. Because as you know, people point out, 95% of your car's life is just sitting there doing nothing. Yeah. And so when you talk about kind of the future of cars in this country, especially, you know, people talk about, you know, having automated driving cars that just kind of go and work for you as you're at work. Then they come back home and then they pick you up and you go back home. But your car the whole day just kind of goes and does like Lyft or Uber for you. Well,
which is so
better use of the car.
Now with we have all of that established,
Let's talk about how we hate scooters.
The e-scooters.
Fuck those things.
Or as we referred to in our last episode.
The Scooty McDouchebacks?
Scooty McDumbasses. Like,
oh, dumbasses?
I was tired of you scooting around this issue.
Because I do listen to all the episodes I'm not even on.
So the scooters, the e-scooters, again, they are the newest presentation, the newest offering of a solution to the last mile.
Are there three different companies?
I've seen at least three. Skip, Bird, and
Lime.
What?
Lime.
Yeah.
They all have four letters?
Yep.
Did they plan that?
Yep. It's a conspiracy, Linsel. We are going to bust the door wide open here on Bikers Dice and Bars.
The nature of scooters is that there's not a lot of places on a scooter that you can print your name if it's longer than four letters.
And I'd just like to point out that much like most swear words, four letters.
Mm-hmm. Flipping the bird.
So, folks.
I did a lot of research on this before I came in.
What are your thoughts on the e-scooters?
Oh, my God.
So I want to state first that Willamette Week did a speed test on them, find out which one was the fastest.
That's exciting.
They put on motorcycle helmets and just kind of went for it. I think the fastest was Bird, I believe, at 19.2 miles an hour, which
is respectable.
It is respectable.
People don't need to be going that fast standing up on things without helmets.
Oh, yeah. They totally do.
So fast. So again, I'm of two minds on this. I do not believe in helmet laws. I'm just going to say that.
We've had this conversation.
Yeah.
I don't even believe that they help.
There is there is research that shows you are more likely to get into an accident with a helmet on than without.
We've covered that topic.
But I also find it really bizarre that despite the rash of massive amounts of accidents involving these scooters, that these companies are actively, at least in California, fighting against legislation that would require people to actually wear helmets on these things, which just kind of seems like maybe not great corporate stewardship.
Yeah, that's a little reprehensible.
Well, from the same companies that can't put a decent light on their vehicles.
And I have seen them at night lately, and they are dark.
Mm-hmm. The scooters are too?
Oh, yeah.
Worse.
Yeah. Worse than the bikes, and the bikes are bad. I think that people think that they're fun toys.
Look like they're fun toys.
Yeah.
Like I see like people riding around. They look like they're having fun.
Yeah, but, you know, it's... They race you at 15 miles an hour to, I guess, 19 miles an hour. And I don't think people put the responsibility that they need to in them. And that's on them, the person. Sure. But also, having read of the copious amounts of accidents that these things are causing due to poor maintenance on them, because their basic maintenance structure is a customer has to flag when there's a problem. Mm-hmm. But if your accelerator is stuck and there's a guy who went, you know, head over heels at 15 miles an hour into the middle of an intersection, broke his jaw in two places, and then...
I'm going to say this. Before we started talking about this and we were jamming on this topic for the last week, and Jacob, you mentioned that there were deaths. I looked them up. I didn't find any.
Really?
I didn't find any either.
I tried to corroborate this information, and I couldn't find any.
There have definitely been accidents.
Lots of serious injuries.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't found any reports of lots of things. Maybe a handful?
But, I think there was one... I believe in Portland, there's been one death.
Yeah.
I believe I saw one, but one.
There was one death and then a couple in San Francisco that left a total of five.
Oh, it's a small number.
It's a small number.
But the amount of personal injuries that are serious are apparently quite high. And I was reading an article in the Washington Post that had listed a personal injury lawyer in Santa Monica that just in the month of July had fielded over 100 phone calls of personal injuries involving these things.
Well, that's just the opportunistic American people. They're going to file personal injuries and everything.
Or, you know, I mean, but there's also hospital records to back this up.
Right. No, I mean, but seriously, you can acquire any commercial good whatsoever. And if you do a stupid thing with it, you get to sue the company that made it.
I'm not talking about lawsuits. Yeah. I'm just talking about the number of injuries are high.
Yeah.
No,
because people aren't using them well.
Well, those things are all over the Southern California. I went down there in spring. I
can't even imagine now.
I actually drove through some of my old stamping grounds in the Santa Monica area, and I was blown away by just how many of those scooters there were. It is actually the first time, because I haven't been in the Bay Area in ages, and it was the first time I've really seen that kind of level of it. And at the time, I was kind of surprised and taken aback by it. And I was like, what is this crap? But I can see how there is a benefit, especially for people who are visiting from out of town or for people who have a short jaunt to and from like a MAC station and they don't want to walk or whatever. I can see that there is uses for them. They look like a lot of fun. The only time I've had any experience, I stood on one and didn't pay for it, and it made a really, really unpleasant siren noise. I was like, oh, I can just step on this and go downhill here for a block, and that did not work.
No. They let you know.
They are heavy, surprisingly heavy.
Really?
Yep. Yeah.
And that's like one of the problems with them.
It's like a 40-pound scooter, you know? It's no joke.
I almost thought about taking one here to the show today. Just leave it in front of your...
I also thought the same thing.
And I biked instead.
I find them annoying as shit. Yeah. However,
is it the scooter or the people on them?
That's I have to constantly reaffirm why it is that I feel so badly about them. And I I'm in this stage of my life where I'm trying to be less judgmental about shit that I dislike.
You're a bad person for doing that.
The scooters, I find annoying as shit, but then I was like, okay, is that just like a knee-jerk reaction because it's new and people are doing things and having fun?
And I'm just getting all get off my lawn.
Am I wanting them to get off my lawn?
Back in my day, we never had fun.
I think it's the people. Most I see people abusing those things. I see people trying to ride two up on them. I see criddlers dragging them off into the lake or the, mm-hmm. the
so
lake.
You just think it attracts bad people.
Yeah. Things like that.
Irresponsible.
As useful as they could be to solve the problem with the last mile or the short jaunt when it's a hot day and you don't feel like sweating is they're so ripe for abuse by idiots.
Yeah.
So one of the things I'd point out is if you look. And just going to put a trigger warning to one of my friends at the table here. If you look at car shares versus bikes versus scooters, we're all in agreement that the car share thing and Uber and all that is generally been a really successful thing with a few bumps here and there, but generally a successful introduction.
Yeah.
Then you look at bike share and then you look at scooter share. And two of the biggest problems with both of those is the quality of the good, mm-hmm. the quality of the feature on it, mm-hmm. and then user issues. Well, people are going to be people.
Yeah.
People are going to misuse things. NPC's right on that. And yeah. I totally agree with him. But
we should
look at the car shares, which came in as a regulated good, with safety features and minimal lighting requirements, et cetera, they came in and weren't nearly the problem we've seen with the bike share and scooter share, yeah. where it's substandard lights and maintenance issues that don't have regulatory issues. But if we put decent lights and decent equipment in these things, I think a lot of my problems with them would be improved.
Yeah.
I would just say really quickly, though, the difference between car share and scooter share and bike share is that car share is a person's actual car. And so if you don't give a good ride and your car sucks, you're going to go and get a bad...
Who owns car to go?
Exactly. The car to...
You're going to get a bad rating for that and no one's going to use your product. Whereas with bike share and these electric scooters, it's just some company that's going to put out a cheap product to make money fast. They're... motivation is not necessarily to go and make the highest quality product possible.
Right.
I think that's the big difference.
Well, it's also a matter of exposure too, right? These scooters and those bike town bikes, they sit outside all year long. Right. They're sitting in exposure to the elements. I'm sure that none of you bikers leave your bikes on your driveway all year long.
Not anymore.
No. Nope. You know, like ultimately you want to put that stuff away. And the nature of even one of those mini car or cartigos is that at the very least it stays waterproof. You know, it's not being subjected to the elements all the time. And with these scooters, you know, the nature of these electric scooters is that they're not designed for what these scooter share companies are doing.
Exactly.
Let's see how winter treats these things.
Exactly.
Yeah, this is the first year and it's been sunny.
Oh, holy smokes. Oh, yeah. I can't even imagine what they're going to be like in the winter.
Once that ice comes.
The rain. Yeah. I mean, mm-hmm. and just the nature mm-hmm. of them being exposed to the elements day in and day out, I'm sure they're going to have all kinds of maintenance problems.
I think we have yet to see the spike of injuries from these things.
So let's close this thing out here. We've been going really long on this topic because we apparently have some pretty intense opinions on them. I think you're right. I think we have to wait and see what happens. And I think those accident lists are going to rise, especially in the next few months. And once mm-hmm. we hit winter here in Portland with our icy hills, it's going to suck.
Yep.
So don't be a Scooty McDumbass. Ride responsibly.
Wear a fucking helmet.
And remember, the scooters don't go on the sidewalk except to park.
Yep.
Yeah, that's a real issue.
Done.
And we're back. For the game section tonight, I am drinking Switchel with Bacardi Pineapple Fusion Rum.
Oh, so bad.
Oh, God.
This. What were you thinking?
Oh, God. Here's the thing, Jacobs. I didn't realize that you could make something worse than a crown apple.
Anyways, we're going to talk about the last turn. The last turn, which might include this drink I'm drinking here for me. But when it comes to games, how a game ends impacts how we remember that game and how much we enjoy that game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There are games that I actually really love to play, except for that motherfucking last turn. Because either the math is really is longer than any other phase of the game to figure out who actually won or lost, or the last turn is by the style of the game driven to be this, everybody tries to screw the person who's ahead, or it's a god-awful ending to a video game. Yes, Mass Effect, I'm looking at you. But
we should clarify Mass Effect 3.
Yeah, Mass Effect 3.
I think Mass Effect Andromeda also could be a horrible turn as well.
It was the last turn for that studio.
Yeah.
They basically ended the whole Mass Effect franchise with Andromeda. They had big expectations to fulfill after the shit show that was the magical space baby in the ABC.
Yeah, I'm going to stand up and defend Mass Effect Andromeda, and that I like that game after all the bugs were... Okay, so 3 months after it came out is when it was a really fun game to play.
If a game costs many, many millions to make and is like considered a flagship of a franchise...
you should get it right when it comes out.
You should get it right when it comes out.
Or at least not to the point of how fucking buggy it was when it came out, because it was awful.
AAA games don't get to fuck up. Doesn't matter whether they're a video game or a board game or a card game. But that's the core thing. There's great games. Like, I know people who love playing Mass Effect 3 but cannot get over that ending.
Mass Effect 3 was in many ways a fantastic, wonderful game. That game made me cry. There's a story, this almost a throwaway story moment in it that brings tears to my eyes just thinking about it. And it pains me that the ending of that game was so atrocious that I remember the ending more than I remember that emotional moment for me.
Can you guys think of games, video or, let's stick with the video since we're talking about it, that had a last turn that was really satisfying, that was, really what you were looking for?
Fallout 3.
Fallout 3's ending was awful
until
they added DLC to fix it.
Right, because there was no way to get the super mutant to go and do the thing that the super mutant should have done for you.
Oh, we need you to go step into this irradiated chamber here.
You're like, why don't you do that, dude?
But we need you and you to press this button. And then you turn to either the super mutant or the ghoul who's with you and say, hey, man, can you do it? And they literally have recorded dialogue that says, no can do, sir. This is your journey. I'm like, you could literally just walk in there and press this button, dude. Just do it. And they had to patch that with DLC.
So I played it with the patch.
And the DLC was good.
So that's how I got it.
I played it at launch and it was awful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the whole thing with Liam Neeson as your father and the made you cry at the end. It was good. It was amazing.
There was a lot of great stuff to do at the end of that game.
Yeah.
But both Fallout 1 and Fallout 2 had good endings.
Yeah, that's a whole...
You're
showing your age, Jacob.
If you actually make it to the end of Jagged Alliance 2, my God. Best payoff for a video game ever.
Jagged Alliance 2? Holy smokes, I haven't thought about that game for a while.
I'm the old man.
I'm going to go back further than that. Nintendo Entertainment System, the X-Men game, was one of the worst fucking endings ever.
Yeah.
You get to the end, you defeat the boss, like five words of text go, hey, congratulations, and then the game's over. Like, well, fuck you.
And got it.
Yeah, often the endings to video games feel like they're just sort of, we've done this big thing, so that's all there is. Thanks, guys. And you're like, oh, wait, roll credits, what?
Yeah, Rage was one that came out a few years ago. Yeah.
You showed me that.
Well, what makes a game have satisfying ending? What about an ending to a video game can make that ending positive and satisfying?
I think you need a sense of accomplishment.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I have just completed this great and epic thing. I think that's a lot of it. I think a lot of it, too, is an ending that makes sense. And this is more possible in the modern day age. Mm. An ending that makes sense with the character that you created. So having multiple endings, I think, is a good thing. Mm. That makes sense for the character that you have made and put through the whole thing. Forcing an ending. There's only one ending. but it doesn't make sense to your character. It's just like, well, you go, my character wouldn't have done that. That's dumb.
Especially open world RPGs.
That's looking at you every iteration of the Elder Scrolls. Yeah.
Yeah.
Ultimately, what you want is a satisfying conclusion based on two main components, a mechanical conclusion and a narrative conclusion. Now, some games will have more of one than the other. Like a visual novel is not going to really have so much with mechanical, but it's going to have high narrative. I tend to play a lot of games that have a balance of both. But ultimately, the mechanical conclusion is, in order to be satisfying, you want to feel like all of the skills that you have learned or all of the planning that you have put into your character. I mean, this could be something like a platformer that becomes increasingly complex, or a role-playing game like Divinity, like, which I've noticed you've been playing a lot
recently. I have. Yeah, my wife and I have been playing.
You want that feeling that the mechanics are at the end a culmination of everything that you have learned and built towards, and you want that satisfaction of, I did this well. I have mastered these skills and I have put all of them to the test. Whereas the narrative, you want the feeling of accomplishment that your story choices have a bearing, and you want closure. You want
that
to feel
story like, choices matter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because I think if you're playing a role-playing game especially, which I think is what we're mostly talking about, is that if your decisions and everything that you have done in a game, if none of it seems to matter in the conclusion, then what's the fucking point?
What's the point?
Yeah.
Deus Ex, The Human Revolution, was a
great,
wonderful
game.
And people were complaining about the bosses, but and I hated the bosses too, but I found the ultimate cheese trick to each one of them, and I looked it up online, used the trick, defeated the boss in 10 seconds and moved on.
Yeah.
Right.
But the end of that game was so much of a letdown. It was the exact same ending of Mass Effect. Hmm. I'll need you to go in here and press one of three buttons. What? What?
Well, to a certain extent, you didn't even get the different colors.
Hmm. No, you didn't. You just got a different gravelly voice narration. Mm-hmm. I didn't ask for this.
Hey,
I didn't ask for
good.
That either. I really didn't ask for
you
this.
You should
one.
Totally be a vocal actor for video games.
No, that's good.
Solid.
I would love to, but I live in Portland. There's not really a scene for that here. I live in Portland, and I'm never going to California.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, they have amazing scooters down there.
Let me have a few more of these Switchels and I'll hop right on one and just ride on to California.
Yeah. But so, switching. Oh, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
I was going to say, switching gears to like board games and card games, how a game ends again, like I can't stand Monopoly if it's not played completely by the rules and has the never ending acceleration circle or. God, Risk is a great game until the end where we're suddenly trading, you know, every turn people are picking up another 40 armies and we're trading back and forth. You know, so many board games really suck in how they end because they don't end cleanly or the math on who's the winner is so involved.
A lot of board games break down in the last turn, especially if they are games where you see they're competitive games where there is a victory point counter where everyone else is watching someone else about to win. And then they're like, well, it's the last turn. That guy's about to win. Let's all fuck him.
Yeah.
Like, but what you had such a strategy carefully planned throughout this point. Well, I'm not going to win. So fuck him.
You.
I mean, that it kills me. I hate it.
Yeah.
Do you like that more or less than the person who holds the grudge through the entire game because they were fucked on turn one with something and they've been waiting the whole game to fuck you back? And, and now that it matters, they're like, hey, remember turn one?
I, too, used to love playing Lunch Money.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Lunch Money is one of those games that is off of my rotation.
Yeah.
It's just a dick game.
Yes, well,
I'm going to play the hippie card and call it a day.
In its defense, Lunch Money made no pretense that it wasn't a dick game.
Oh, here's one that has no last turn, Munchkin.
Oh, God.
Munchkin's one of those games that everybody just gives up because there's no way to win it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then you just fuck the person.
And yet it's so popular, and everyone loves it.
So popular.
Don't get it.
Munchkin is not playing a card game. Munchkin is joining a cult.
Yeah.
Especially if you have all the expansions.
Plus the t-shirt that gives you the bonus, plus the, you know.
They had funny concepts. I will give them that. They had funny concepts, but again, the end, it got old fast.
Yeah. Really very fast.
Munchkin is really just one joke that they just keep telling over and over again.
You know, a game that has a really great last turn that solves the problem of knowing who's in the lead is Cashing Guns. It's the game where you point foam pistols at the rest of the people at the table and you're fighting over money that's on the table. And you either have to back out at the last minute in case too many people are pointing their guns at you or shoot each other. And each turn, you're dividing up all of this money that's on the table, and that money goes face down in a pile in front of somebody.
Right.
So you can see how tall their pile is, but you don't see what the denominations are. And unless you're Rain Man style savant, you're not going to know how many points everybody at the tables each got. And so it solves the problem of having the sort of I know this person's in the lead situation.
Do we think that games that take away any kind of marker of victory, does that take away competition, or is it bad?
What do you mean when you say that?
Okay, so like in games like Munchkin, you know, you can see how many points someone has, what level they're at. You get to level 10, you win the game, whatever. If that component is not there, does that ruin any kind of sense of urgency, or do you think that that's just how a game should be at the end, opening up to the table?
Thanks for explaining.
Well, many of those games where you can't see how well someone is doing are also those games where the last turn is spending almost as much time as you spent playing the game counting points.
Yeah.
Oh, God, it's maddening.
I hate that. And part of the reason why I hate that is that I have a mistrust of players at the table. Not that I think that they are cheating, but I think sometimes they're incapable of counting.
Or sometimes the game's math is so complicated. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, there's a difference between people who have problems counting or perhaps drank a little too much over the course of the game and mathematics skills are impaired. And then there's games like Agricola where you need an advanced algebra degree just to figure out who actually won. I'm a kind of a big fan of games that have both a victory track but surprise points at the end combo.
Yeah.
Like
hidden rolls.
Risk 2033 or whatever it was. It's the futuristic version of Risk.
Yeah.
There were two different ways to get basically stashed points that no one knew until the very end of the game. Plus, it had a victory track. So you could do these come from behind wins that no one knew. So
that's pretty satisfying.
In fact, you actually kind
of... That's good.
You actually sabotaged yourself if you went for hitting the guy who looked in the lead because... You actually needed to be more concerned about number two, usually.
Yeah. So.
There was a game that I think it's called Five Tribes. It's got like the one where you have to set up like people that worship the different elements, and then you set up a whole bunch of things around. Anyway, it's one of those worker placement games, essentially, and you could build up some victory points. And I've only played it once, and this is my experience with it. I realized in the first turn that I hated it. I hated this game. But I was hanging out with some friends, and I was there to meet some other friends. And I was like, I'm not going to be that guy who just bails after the first turn. So I'm going to play the whole game all the way through. So I realized I hated it. And all I did was wait. There's this bidding mechanic. You get to bid with points to see who gets to go first and who gets to choose first. So I decided I would never bid for anything. And I would spend all I would do was take the last available, most obvious action each turn. I won by a landslide.
Wow.
Everyone else was focusing on doing these different things, and I, the player who did not care, and again, the game had one of those, now we got to spend 15 minutes counting the points at the end. I'm like, whatever. I knew I was going to lose. It's like, I don't even care anymore. I'm going to lose. I knew who was going to win. And I even knew what order it was going to happen in. It was an exact reverse of that.
Right.
The guy that I thought was going to win was in the last place. And yeah. Well, anyway, board games that have a satisfying final conclusion, I think, are the ones, they tend to be simpler.
Yeah.
Like one that comes to mind is Blockus.
Oh, sure. Well, that game can be satisfying, but you also can realize that you are trapped.
You are trapped.
And you're like, oh, well, I know what I'm doing for the last three turns.
Yeah. but it's also the kind of game that encourages you to play against each other. Like, actively make moves against each other in a satisfying way that doesn't just come out of nowhere as being a dick.
Yeah.
Yeah. Year of the Dragon is not a simple game, but the way the point score works is very easy to figure out. And because points can be scored a couple different ways, different strategies can be non-competitive. And it's how well did you play your strategy and how well did the random elements benefit or not.
There's a Kickstarter game that I'm a big fan of called King's Forge, where you are competing weaponsmiths and sort of metallurgy crafters. The game is essentially a dice building game. So on each turn, you are much like a deck builder, recruiting dice. And that dice is sort of added to your pool. And on each turn, then you're rolling whatever dice that you've got left to try and craft items. And what this leads to is a fantastic last turn where everybody has tons and tons of dice and everybody's trying to craft the last few possible crafting items. And they're all getting to roll handfuls of 10 dice and look at these big rolls. Something about that is really satisfying.
Yeah.
Watching your person across from you roll all their dice and looking across the table and saying, oh my God, they've got so many dice, but they're one magic die. I only rolled the one. Oh, they're not going to be able to craft this turn. Hooray!
Well, I mean, again, that's just the buildup. Like a good buildup for a giant conclusion at the end, I think, is what we're talking about for a very satisfying last turn.
Especially for a board game.
Yeah, because otherwise, why are you building up to it?
Right.
Yeah.
As long as the conclusion is not some drawn out math or some
math problems at the end.
Screw your neighbor sort of thing.
Okay, I got a question for you guys. Is the last turn less satisfying if the game is short? If you play, say, a game of Love Letter that has a very satisfying ending, but the game itself took not even 5 minutes, is that really different from sitting down to 12 hours of Twilight Imperium?
I'm going to go with yes.
Like, what is the more satisfying final turn? The big final turn to the really long game, or the final turn that you can have four or five of in a night?
12 hours of Imperium. Yeah, I'll go with Love Letter. 12 hours of marathon high level games of diplomacy. I'd stick with that.
Oof, I have always wanted to play diplomacy.
I can't do it. Yeah.
Always wanted to do this.
You and I will talk offline, sir.
Yes. Yes.
Twilight Imperium is one of my favorite games.
It's epic.
It's epic. It's amazing. It's a lot of fun. And
wanted to play that too.
We could do a whole episode just talking about Twilight Imperium stories. It's a fantastic game.
Ooh, perhaps someday we should do a marathon play of Twilight Imperium
and then record the highlights and play them.
The last turn of Twilight Imperium is almost universally awful.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, first off, a lot of times you don't even get to have a last turn because you've been playing for 12 hours and everybody's got to go home and go to bed. And
then you gotta pack the game up. I think almost all of my Twilight experiences have resolved in a, all right, I guess we should just be done now.
Yeah. But even if you make it to that last turn, some people are going to start just fucking each other up. And what you might be able to just say that that's how galactic war would be.
Yeah.
This one group that nobody really likes because nobody here likes each other at all is about to win. So everybody's like, you know what? We like this chaos and we're in a wartime economy. So we're booming. Let's go fuck them up and keep it going.
What is the end of Twilight Imperium supposed to actually represent?
You take over the galaxy.
It's not like the turn limit or something is like, all right, this is it. After this, the world is destroyed if you don't do something.
No, you end up becoming the new emperor, ruling household of the Imperium.
And I totally agree. I find that totally dissatisfying, even though, once again, tipping my hand to my age, I grew up on Avalon Hill bookshelf series games.
Yeah.
So sitting down for
and all that jazz.
12 eyes light up.
Yeah, Avalon Hill. I get excited.
Sitting down for a 12-hour game or Age of Napoleon, the only game they rated as an 11 out of test scale of 1 to 10. I'm okay with that, but it's when it's just a firefight at the end.
Can I ask a quick question? Several of you at the table have said Twilight Imperium, one of your favorite games, and yet you've also both said the ending is the most unsatisfactory thing ever.
It is.
So I'm curious.
There's a dichotomy happening.
Yeah, here. I'm just If the ending is one of your least favorite things of a game, then why play the game?
Do you enjoy drinking copious amounts of alcohol?
Yes, I do.
Do you enjoy hangovers?
I don't get them.
Well, fuck you.
I like the idea that the last turn of Twilight Imperium is equivalent to a hangover. Not for lack of effort.
I'm just immune to hangovers.
The payoff for Twilight Imperium.
Yes.
And it's more in the experience.
Is the 12 hours of drinking.
It's the 12 hours of hanging out with your friends.
Okay.
Engaging in intergalactic conflict. Almost ruining some friendships.
Yeah,
preparing those friendships.
You later betray.
Yeah.
I will say that.
Okay. I get it.
I will say
that. That's fair.
Part of the reason Twilight Imperium works is the reverse of your earlier point, where if a game is short, Twilight Imperium is so goddamn long and during its length is so goddamn fun that even though the ending sucks, they've built up so much goodwill towards the game based on
experience.
The game and the social interaction that it gets you to jump the hump.
Mm-hmm. Jump the hump.
So it is like
is that
Mass
a biking
Effect
term? 3.
Yeah.
I do not feel that many co-op games have unsatisfactory endings because you've all worked together. So,
yeah, although there's times where the ending can be a foregone conclusion. I certainly, in one of our favorites, The Captain is Dead, there's lots of times where you can see that you're going to succeed a couple of turns away from that success. So then it's like, oh, yeah, just do this. And then like the next person, you're like, well, you don't really need to do anything because the engineer is going to win for us. So why don't you just sit on your thumb this round?
that's happened a few times, but still, it is very satisfying.
There is a communal, unless you lose, obviously.
Yeah, with cooperative games, they do a lot better a job of having satisfying endings. Because if they go off the rails, they usually go off the rails well before the ending. You either have the jerk who's trying to micromanage everything, or you're playing Escape from Innsmouth,
So we talked about the last mile and we talked about the last turn. I think it's time that we talked about last call.
Woo! Wait, what time is it?
It's still early.
But God.
It's 2:30 a.m. somewhere.
Don't worry, there's still time for a drink. But I still thought it was appropriate to talk about the end of the night when you're out at the bar and the bartenders decided that it's time for things to be done and they want to go home for the night. And so they call out last call. And then 15 minutes later, you get up to the bar and you're like, hey, did you call last call? And you're like, yeah, I did call last call. I'm not serving you. There's definitely a point in the night where things are done and it's time to move on. And I feel like last call has a long past. I was one of the bartenders who loved yelling last call at the top of my lungs.
And I love it when bartenders do that.
There's something very satisfying about that.
Both as a bartender and also as a consumer.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Absolutely. I feel like it creates a ritual in a way.
And it lets people know that this actually is the last call.
Yeah.
You have one chance and it is right now.
Yeah.
There is no more, but I didn't, but I... No, it is a finality.
It is
great. And it's a ritual for everybody to go and have their last good drink of the night.
Absolutely.
One bar I worked at, we didn't yell last call because the music was so loud, no one was ever going to do it. We had a switch we hit, which fired 2 strobe lights.
What?
And turned off all of the alcohol brand signs behind the bar.
That's dramatic.
That's super fancy.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
I put together an hour-long playlist on my iPod, which I would put on an hour before last call for some years. And it included a lot of ridiculous songs that you probably could imagine, including a little semisonic. But ultimately, I included like Tom Waits and Allen Ginsberg, the kind of stuff the kind of stuff that I felt like would give people the sense that things were winding up, mellowing out the night.
What was your Tom Waits song?
I actually have Tom Waits' Closing Time, which is instrumental, but I have that instrumental piece merged together with Allen Ginsberg's America Poem. which is kind of fantastic.
So you're just trying to make people feel like shit. This is awesome. This is great.
Well, you know.
I approve of this. I was going to say, if it's small change, that would be great. You know, small change got rained on by his own 38. That's a good end of the night song.
Yeah. Or for somebody who wants to go outside and get shot.
Yeah. Or the piano has been drinking, not me. That's what I would really do. Because at that point,
that's
I believe
song I
you.
I play during the day, though.
Yeah. for your day drinking, folks.
Yeah.
I cannot remember the last time I closed out a bar. It has been a long time.
Really?
I my weekday schedule keeps me up at 5. I'm up at 5:30 in the morning.
Real life. Just keeping you from drinking. That is a drag.
I'm a lifelong insomniac.
You just pick your times.
I'm just drinking before everyone else is.
Do you work for one of those tech companies here in Portland where they get to drink at their desks?
Yeah, maybe. I work at a tech company that has copious amounts of booze around the office, including 4 beers on tap.
But nobody's calling last call at your work, presumably.
I think that has probably happened a few times in the past when it was a much rowdier company.
How do you guys feel about bars that you go to and rather than somebody shouting last call, you have a bartender going around to each table and kind of tucking down the table and saying, hey guys, I'm just doing last call now, is that all right, you know, let's moving on. Is that does that feel underwhelming?
I mean,
depends on the bar.
It depends on how crowded it is too, because
on a romantic night at a romantic bar, it's kind of nice to have a little bit of a personal attention.
Mm-hmm. No, I can appreciate that.
It depends on the bar. It depends on the occupancy of the bar, and it depends. Like, one of the things I hated having to do when I was tending was do that if it meant that I had to leave the bar and circulate 45 minutes before last call in order to tell all the tables that was going to happen.
Sure. So it'd take a long time.
Right.
Yeah. It's not worth it.
Not worth it. And that's also the time of the night where I really wanted to be behind the counter because, again, my license is on the line if someone gets into the cab intoxicated. And me being behind the bar to go, hey, bud, how about we call you a cab? It's on me.
Yeah.
Because he's going to try to make that play for the last drink. But because I'm out walking around, he sees I'm not behind the bar and therefore heads out to the street on his own. You know, I missed that opportunity and I hated missing that opportunity.
Do you ever have the moron who, when you call last call and then seeing that nobody steps up for last call, you start to do some other things, step in the back, do cleaning up or whatever.
You're closing
and
duties.
Then you come back up front and that asshole is at the actual tap trying to serve himself.
Oh,
what is that about?
I might have accidentally done that on my trip to. It was really close. I was going to this brewery in Charleston, and it said closed on Mondays, and it was a Monday, and I was like, "Well, I'm going to try the door anyways," and it was open, and I was like, "Oh,
nice!
How exciting!" And so I walked in. I was like, oh, "Great! I get a beer at this place," and I walked in, and like, there's no one there, and I'm looking around, I'm like, "Oh, this is." Someone just left the door open. So I'm at this brewery by myself with no one there with all the taps right there. And I'm like,
just pour myself a sampler.
Well, and I was like, well, is there a glass around? I don't know. And then at the very last minute, I'm like, oh, cool. There's like a water jug with a bunch of plastic glasses. I'll just pour myself a quick sampler. And at that point, I saw the brewer like walking around in the, because it's open glass where the brewery is, with actually brewing beer. And I was like, all right, that's my little ticket to get out of here. But I was close. I almost did it. I'm sorry.
That reminds me of a picture I saw on the internet of a pizza box that's open and there's like only a few scraps of pizza left, and there's a possum lying in the pizza box and its belly is distended and it says, do your worst. I have already succeeded in life. Imagine just being like, all right, cool, poor. They come in and they find you on the ground covered in their beard. You're like, do your worst.
I've already done my best.
I have already won.
One of the things I absolutely hated, and when I was working in bars that served mostly railroad personnel, this was the worst. College bars and railroad bars. College bars, railroad bars, and union bars. Yep. Those were the three that I spent a lot of time in. And you'd call last call, and a table of four would come up and order
four rounds,
a shot apiece, and two large pitchers. Now, large pitchers are a Midwest, upper Midwest thing. It's minimum 64 ounces and routinely more. And you could
take some time.
But you had to share it with another person. So a table of four could get two large pitchers.
Yeah.
And four shots. And you're like, oh, God.
Yeah, and you weren't in a position where you could say, hey, that means you're going to be here for another 2 hours, and that's not going to happen.
That's just a douchebag thing to do.
Yeah.
What's actually funny is I currently work for a bar that does not do last call. They don't shout it out.
Really?
No, they don't shout it out.
Just turn the sign off or something? Or
no, it's you know, the last bar on the property either closes at 1 or 2 a.m., and if you're not there by 1 or 2 a.m., you don't get a drink.
Yeah.
They don't give a warning. Mm-hmm. They don't do anything else. But if it's past 2 a.m. on Friday and Saturday nights, like, it's your responsibility to go and find it.
McMenamins have always been weird that way, too. Like, I've never, they just feel so weird on that.
They've got a way of doing, you know, they've been doing business in this town for so long and successfully. You can't really begrudge it. But they have a internal system that I guess kind of works for them.
Well, and the thing that is, you know, so if you buy a drink at 1:59 a.m. on a Saturday night and you get it from the last bar that's open on the property, because you can drink anywhere on the property, they'll sell you that drink at that time because you don't have to necessarily leave at that time.
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
So, where I work, it's a very different set of liquor laws.
Yeah.
But I also don't mind that they're not running out and like shouting last call throughout the 74 acres that they have.
Yeah, well, because especially because there's like a hotel and everything else around there too. It doesn't seem like it's like last call. Anybody wants to come down for their room?
Yeah, they could totally like yell it over their intercom system, but that would just ruin the ambiance.
Yeah, that's not good.
I will say though, one of my favorite moments of being at the Sandy Hut was, you know, I was there at like 2:29 a.m. and they were doing last call. And then when they did last call, they then just went and locked the door.
Mm-hmm.
Nice. All right. So I will say one thing about last call now that you just reminded me. I hate bar time. I hate it.
Oh,
bar time? As a patron, bar time is the worst.
Oh, having your clock set different?
Runs like 15 minutes ahead.
Yeah, I hate that shit. You know what? Yeah. I don't get to do that at my job. You don't get to do that at yours.
Yeah.
Fuck you. Some people say, oh, whatever, it's just a thing of the industry. You should just learn to accept it. You know, I think it's just a douche thing. Like,
it doesn't really
as a bartender, I hate it.
Yeah.
As a bartender, I hated it.
Yeah. I never understood it. I always set my clock to the right time. And then
because you're a good human being.
If I wanted to close the bar early, I'd say, we're closing early. I wouldn't be like,
you were upfront about it.
Let me trick you and pretend like it's somehow 20 minutes early.
My favorite diner is, you know what? I'm not going to say their name because I'm going to kind of badmouth them here. Because I actually fucking love this diner. It's great people, but they do that whole, they have their bars, their clock set 10 minutes ahead.
Bar time, yeah.
They open at 7 a.m. That doesn't mean they open at 6:50 though. And some days it's 6:50. I've been like, come on, it's 7. That's what your clock says.
No, that doesn't work that way.
Nope. Yeah, no, and having worked in bars that operated in both bar time and non-bar time, because you don't work in a railroad bar unless that clock is set to railroad time.
Sure. Right.
I prefer it when we're running on real time. I understand, having worked in college bars, how many fights it actually does save and how much it does save your ass when the cops show up to do a last call check. But it's not worth it.
I will say, as a bartender, I also use last call as a way to get additional tips. You know, there is a technique to going around to telling your patrons that it's last call. And then and then when they say, oh, should I just knock this beer down real quick so I can get another one? I'll say, don't worry about it. It's fine. I'll make sure to serve you. Like, you kind of give them a little bit of like, oh, you don't need to rush. Like, it's last call, but I'll take care of you.
You get that taken care of. We're cool, bro.
Yeah.
But
you give them the regular treatment.
Yeah.
Just you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
You don't need to rush.
That's why you go to your bar.
I'll pour you another one.
Have you ever done that specifically to the single guy who's sitting at the bar who, you know, if you tell him that, he's going to tip you big on the last one?
Even though it might be a little... I just pour the drink. I don't even ask. If I've got somebody who's been camping at the bar for a while and I do last call and they've still got a beer in front of them and they knock it down, I'm already giving them the other one. I'm like, yeah, here, I'm just going to put this here. I'm sure it'll go away later.
Any other thoughts on last call? Like, what do you have any? What's your worst last call story?
Well, okay, Linsel? So this is kind of an odd little anecdote. I used to drink across the street from the tugboat at Bailey's Tap Room.
Yep.
Yeah.
Still around, still kicking. I love the place.
It's fine.
Jeff is, he's got a great selection of beers on. They're doing good stuff.
Got a love-hate relationship with it, but yeah, I understand.
Yeah, so
it's on Mondays. It's the digital tap board. That's what I hate about it.
Yeah, yeah, it's a little, you know, it's not as digital as it looks.
It's a fucking television.
Yeah, yeah. But it's not like they're actually measuring the amount of beer in the kegs. They're just measuring the amount of beer that they've sold out of each keg. That's anyway, doesn't matter. So in any case, on Monday nights, I would work at the tugboat. We'd close up at about 10 o'clock on Monday, and I'd take whoever was left across the street to Bailey's to drink more. And I was sitting there, in Bailey's, and the bartender whose name escapes me, it wasn't Scotty, but whoever the bartender was, told one of the guys at the bar, it's last call. And then that guy took it upon himself to yell it out. Not the bartender, no. The patron yelled out last call.
Boo.
And I got pissed. Like, I was like, that uncouth. Is, there is a sanctity to last call, yeah. Mister. Uncouth. That is not your responsibility to shout that out. If she told you that, that is private information until she tells everybody.
That is
a coworker of yours?
No, it was not.
Just a random person you
took.
It
was just a random person sitting in a bar that I had gone into where I was friends with.
Doing the sacraments without ordinance.
Yeah.
Sometimes people, you know, everybody manifests their drunkenness in a different way. Some people get belligerent. Some people get happy. Some people get creepy. Some people get grumpy. But some people get helpful. Helpful drunks.
Oh, that's those are good.
Oh my god.
And that guy sounds like he was probably a helpful drunk. He's like, oh, well, let's call. Oh, we'll help her out. Let's call. Like, oh, dude.
No. Helpful. There are rules. No.
Yeah.
The guy that I came back from changing a keg and he was slicing my limes. Oh my god. To this day.
Hey man, those limes you didn't have to slice.
They're not gonna slice themselves.
There are terms that I have made recently, which are there's drunk quiet when you are drunk and you think you are quiet, but you are not. Same thing as drunk funny.
Mm.
And I think the other one could be drunk helpful.
Mm.
Drunk helpful.
You know what? When you are drunk and you think you are helpful, but you are not.
Mm. Don't be that guy.
It's last call for that guy.
Don't be that guy.
Don't be that guy.
Speaking of last call.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol, get going. Drink up, drink up, drink up, then order again.
So we hopped on our e-scooters and made that last mile ride to the game. And after the game was over and we finished that last turn, we headed out to the bar. And then the bar fortunately had last call. And here we are now.
I guess this is that post last call time.
This is that post last call time.
Drinking after last call. Yeah.
Linsel, I'm really enjoying this beverage. This Switchel is good.
I
would
tasty
just casually
stuff.
Drink this.
Yeah.
But I'm also drinking it much slower than I've drank anything else that we've recorded. I'm not tanked. I'm not slurring my speech.
Oh,
I'm still holding my pills. This is unusual by this point.
I'm not sure how I like NPCs this sober, this late in the evening.
Yeah.
I'm slightly uncomfortable and I feel alone.
I feel weird.
Have you been watching me?
Always.
Thanks for bringing this, Linsel.
Hey, I'm glad that you got a chance to experiment. Jacob, I apologize for the pineapple rum.
No, sir.
You sit in the corner and you think about what you've done. And you, Jacob, no. If I had a rolled up newspaper, I would take it to you right now.
I certainly would never have recommended you put that much pineapple rum into
anything.
You owe me no apology, sir. I knew what I was doing. I'm a big boy.
Fair enough.
So, Xander, I understand that you had a little bit of a story from the road.
I do have a story from the road. So, I was not here for the last podcast because I was kind of taking a early 5-year anniversary trip with the missus. Nice. We went to Newark to a friend's wedding. We went to Hoboken, Weehawken. These are not names I am making up.
So, Weehawk, by the way, is the name of the elf in Ralph Bakshi's Wizards.
Yes.
And that's the name of the town? Is it based off of Rakshi's Wizards?
Yeah.
Weehawken.
Clearly, it is a town inspired by the elf from Ralph Bakshi's Wizards.
That seems unlikely.
Yeah, the Huron people sure had nothing to do with that.
I'm pretty sure that is a
people
fact.
People from New Jersey, they love wizards.
Yeah. Yes, they do.
Oh, geez.
Great, wow. You broke Jacob again.
Yeah, it's getting tea kettle-y over there.
We went to the Weehawken Dueling Grounds, where and there's a rock that's a monument where Aaron Burr...
Ancient Elven Dueling Grounds?
Yeah. Sure. Yeah.
Was Aaron Burr an elf?
Yeah. Yeah, and apparently Hamilton was an orc, and it just didn't end well.
Oh, my God, I could see a musical.
I have
we
to go.
We should write this.
Yeah.
We should write
this.
Oh,
my God, Hamilton, but elves and orcs and dwarves and
trolls. Wow, why has this not already happened?
Let's roll for our constitution, boys and girls.
Hey, that's a con check at a minus four, my friend.
But anyways, we took the train down from Newark down to Charleston, South Carolina. And Charleston is not just a beautiful town full of lots of history and just gorgeous in general, but Cuddy's Dive Bar in Charleston might be my new favorite dive bar on Earth.
Wow. That's a high mark.
Can you smoke at Cuddy's?
You can't. So slight downfall. We did find the $1 social club at Follies Beach in South Carolina, where the membership costs $1 a year. And you can bring in one guest every time, and you can chain smoke to your heart's content in that place.
Mm. Yeah, okay. You're selling me.
Let's see your membership card.
But Cuddy's. So the first day I was in there, it was like a happy hour all night deal. And I was like, all right, well, what's your cheap whiskey? And they're like, oh, Crow is our well. Great. How much is it? It's $2.50 a shot right now.
You and I would be damaged.
Dead. Yes. And I went, great. I'll take a couple of those. The next night we went in, their daily special for $4 was an Old English 800 40 ounce. Well, supplies last.
I kind of wonder if they just have some strange connection with maybe a local liquor store or distributor that's
mob.
Like, hey,
I have no idea.
This delivery truck got lost on the way, and we now have 500 Old English 40s. Can you do something with them?
I think I can sell them for $4 a piece all day and all night. Yes, I can.
Just going to say that at one time, Charleston was one of the homes of the Irish mob in the United States. Yeah. And liquor has always been their trade.
Yeah, and so...
If only you had a microphone.
I know.
And recorded some,
some
on
sights
the spot.
And sounds.
Yeah.
Sounds. So for $4.50, you got a 12 ounce hams and a shot of Old Crow.
Oh.
Because your liver can go fuck itself.
Were you there for Last Call?
Yeah.
How did they do it?
They shouted out Last Call like any good place should, and people just like went and like got their drinks up and
cattle call.
It was a cattle call
to the bar.
Yeah. And it was also pretty amazing too. The first night we were there, the bartender was like, you have to come back on this other night. So we came back on the night that she told us to, where she was like completely tanked. as a guest, not as a bartender.
Okay.
Sorry. I should clarify. She was being a good bartender. She was not bartending when she was drunk the next night. And everyone was around taking pictures. And I was like, well, what's the big deal? What's going on? Like, oh, well, we had this old this guy used to come here all the time with a huge beard. And he said whenever he was going to shave it off, he was going to gift it to the bar. And he did. But then he moved away. And he also had this like crazy like horn-shaped hair thing.
Goiter.
Sure.
Okay. Horn-shaped goiter?
No.
What?
Linsel, you don't have a goiter. You're turning into a troll.
What?
But so he moved away and he had this like crazy, like horn shaped, like a hair thing because he's never washed it. And
dreadlock?
But he's white. I don't know. And so he said whenever he was going to get rid of it, he was going to also cut it off and mail it to the bar. He had to cut it off for work and had just mailed it to the bar. And everyone was really excited about receiving this.
This is a dive bar.
This is a fucking dive bar.
Yeah, in my decade at the tugboat, nobody ever mailed me hair.
So they were just really excited about receiving this. And so I got I didn't see it, but they were prepping for it. And and they had this great sign at the bar that said, our cheapest beers are PBR, Hams, and Tecate. If you have to ask, the cheapest thing is you.
Oh, well, as cheap drinkers, let's raise a glass to Cuddy's.
To Cuddy's in Charleston.
To Cuddy's in Charleston. I love
Cuddy's. The sweet sound of
Olympia cannon.
So one thing that we did not do at the beginning of this episode is actually introduce who we are.
We figured everybody knew.
Why am I here?
Bikers, Dice, and Bars podcast. We drink, so we kind of forget. And sometimes we drink
to forget.
But we don't like to forget what we drink. And this is the Bikers, Dice, and Bars podcast. I am your organizer, producer, NPC.
This is just Jacob.
Dr. Xander Gerrymander.
And I'm Linsel, like tinsel, but with an L.
So you've been listening to us for God knows how long. We've been recording for so long tonight. And now that we have just introduced ourselves, I want to bid you a good night. Before I do that, I want to thank you for listening and invite you to find us online. We have a Discord server that we'd love to hear from you and hop in and chat with us.
Yep.
We have a Facebook presence. We have a Twitter that is kind of dead right now, but if you tweet us, we will respond.
We have Instagram.
We have all the things. We would love to hear from you. If you like what you hear, we'd like to know more about it. And if you have things that you want to hear us get drunk and talk about, let us know.
There is a special Just Jacob reward for the first person who Twitters us.
Oh, I'm going to get that.
Members of casting crew do not count. Members of casting crew do not count.
I quit and I'll be the first one. I know people say this all the time, but you know, if you want to leave us a review on the Apple iTunes or wherever you get your podcasts, we will read them out loud.
Please do.
On here.
Yes.
Oh, definitely.
As we have done before.
Oh, geez.
We have done that before. We'll do it again. So if you have any comments, questions, critiques, complaints, send them our way.
And again, we want to remind you.
Shiny side up.
Always tip your bartender.
May your dice always roll 20s.
And whatever you do, do not ride one of those goddamn scooters.
And always tip your bartender.
Wait, that's what Xander said.
Tip him twice.
Hey up, big boy.
Thanks for joining us, friend. We've reached the end of Bikers, Dice, and Bars.